Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here. My name is Rohita and I will be your compere for this evening. And in order to start the proceeding, I would like to invite a few important people to light the traditional oil lamp. Starting with Engineer Professor Niranjani Ratnayake, President IESL, Mr. Javala Migoda, immediate past president of IESL, Engineer Gamini Ranasinghe's sister, Ms. Kushnani Amrasurya, Engineer Shanuka Vanyarachi, Chairman IMechE Sri Lanka Group, Engineer Dr. Gamini Kulatunga, and Engineer Mahesh Disanayake, Chairman of Agricultural Section Committee IESL, please come and light the traditional oil lamp. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Next, I would like to invite IMechE Sri Lanka Chairman, Mr. Shanaka, to deliver the welcome speech.
Thank you, Rohit. Good evening, everybody. President of IESL and sister of Engineer Gamini and members of IESL and members of IMechE and then friends of Gamini, I warmly welcome all of you for this remembrance session of late Engineer Gamini Ranasinghe. Gamini has been a tower of strength for IMechE Sri Lanka Group. He is a fellow member of IMechE and he was a board member for maybe last 40 plus years for Sri Lanka IMechE Group. And he was getting on very well with the entire team of the board of management as well as young engineers of IMechE. If you see the gathering here, you will see very young members as well as senior members of IMechE. That shows how Gamini's reach was to the entire membership. I still remember the sessions we had with Gamini, maybe late evening sessions, maybe late night sessions where we had for strategizing and various activities where Gamini is there. It's not monotonous. So many funds, he'll come up with so many stories, his experience as an engineer, maybe his experience in various countries. He was involved in UNIDO, UN and various international organizations, maybe traveling around the globe and holding very senior positions. By doing that, he has gathered many experience of various cultures where many of the engineers don't get that opportunity. And the difference of Gamini was he was very happy to share this experience with others, with young engineers who are just boarding into the professional career path. So he was very generously sharing this information, which was the biggest strength I saw in Gamini of interacting with many layers. He can go to the CEO and he can go to the very low level of employees and then interact with them in the same way. End of the day, you feel him like maybe your father, maybe your brother. So that is the that is how Gamini is. And then I still remember the most successful how to become a chartered engineer. We had a session called Route to Charter, where Gamini articulated the entire session. It was like 2-hour session for young engineers. Show them the path, how to become a chartered engineer. And then a question came from the audience, somebody who came up and asked, what is the difference between an engineer and a chartered engineer, right? Actually, that puzzled me also. Right? There are so many explanations. If you ask, it will take some time for you to explain. Gamini said, son, he wrote a bicycle in the whiteboard. It's a bicycle, this is the sprocket wheel, this is the chain drive, this is how it goes. And then he drew the handle. He said, the bicycle, remaining part of the bicycle is engineering and the handle is the charter. So you need to have a handle being an engineer. So I was amazed to hear that. I've never seen somebody explaining this complex thing very, very easily and then offhand. That is how Gamini is, right? And whatever the lessons, whatever the lectures, sessions he had, it was joyful. It was not very complex, difficult to understand, no. That was not Gamini. He was very joyful, even very difficult thing, he will explain in a way so that it will go to your mind forever. That is how Gamini is. And he, at one time he was a kid, all the time he was a kid, doing so many funny things with the team, and then a very senior person in the team, guiding everybody, giving directions, and sometimes fighting. So that was Gamini. And then I'm sad to say, losing Gamini, I can't imagine. The last day I met, very joyful person. And he was really happy about his business, he was really happy about his dancing classes. So he had a wonderful life. I think he enjoyed his life to the maximum. That I can say. Knowing Gamini, I came to know Gamini for maybe last 6 years, but he's here. He came very close to me. So that was his strength. So without much ado, I close my session. But I would like, I'm really thankful to all of you for being here and then taking part in this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Shanaka, for those lovely words. next, there is a small presentation that I would like to show all that is present here. That basically captures the events done and taken part by Mr. Gamini Ratnayake when he was Agriculture Plantational Engineering Sectional Committee. So please enjoy this. Thank you. Our next item for today's event will be delivered by Dr. Gamini Kulutunga, and it is the Remembrance Lecture. Please, I would like to invite Dr. Gamini Kulutunga to the stage to deliver.
I'm supposed to do a 1 hour oration in remembrance of Gamini, but this oration is going to be slightly different because I was told by the organizers that there might be a time for questions. So if it's a oration, I will just describe who Gamini was, what he had done. There will be very little room for questions. So I'm going to make some space for you to ask me questions by going back to an era where people like Gamini, and there are others, I don't want to mention by name, were the products of the university. At that time there was only one university, which was called University of Ceylon, not University of Peradeniya. How people of that caliber were produced, because I want to reflect on that while talking about Gamini. To be frank, he was not a colleague of mine at the university, he was senior to me. But I think by the time he entered, I think he was an instructor. But then I came to know him quite well and quite closely at the Open University when he became a consultant to us in setting up the Agricultural Engineering Department. I forget the details, so let me look at my notes. I think he's a Kretian, but from Ananda. I think I feel that he was very mischievous. The father would have sent him to Trinity Hostel to be disciplined. Knowing him, I'm just surmising. But I hear you said about he never takes no for an answer. I was told by another Trinitian, when he was in the hostel, there was some sort of a mild form of ragging, or what I would call initiation ceremony, and getting to know the crowd. And you had to sing, he was asked to sing a song in an English song. And a boy from Ananda, not that they wouldn't know English songs, but for some reason or other, he decided to recite Jack and Jill. So he'll never take no for an answer. And then the whole hostel joined him in singing the nursery rhyme Jack and Jill. I don't know how far that's true. His father, a well-known professor, D.A. Ranasinghe, he is ONG obstetrics and gynecology professor who succeeded, I think, Sir Nicholas Artigalla, and then he became Dean of the Medical Faculty, and he was also Chancellor of Columbia University in 1970s or so. So he's quite a illustrious father. I gathered some of it from Anne Ranasinghe's writing, that's his stepmother. So she says somewhere, I'll read that later, she describes him in really vivid terms. Gamini, now we come to Gamini, he graduated in 1966, that's about 40 years ago. I think half the crowd wouldn't have been born even. His career, I don't want to go into his career and his normal information because that you all know, but I want to talk about one aspect of his involvement in activated carbon at Halley's. I think it was at the very inception. I looked up, just to say that how people were creative, not only Gamini at that time, who were creative, I call it the Kulisinghe era. And I looked up the history of Halley's activated carbon. It's around that time, 1970, they started exporting. It says, however, activated carbon manufacture was considered a black art. There were only few factories in the whole world, right? Almost an alchemy, replete with secretive technology and reluctance to give even considered joint ventures. And what did Halley's do? Of course, under Pathirana, it says, undaunted, Hades went ahead with a venture and incorporated HACAB in 1973. HACAB had to rely on then and even as now on the determination, innovation of leaders and employees to develop technology and establish a highly technical global business. That says so even now. That was the era. I want to remind you of that era where Gamini, not only Gamini, a lot of others who are here, were playing. Things have changed. I will come to that later. He was also, as you mentioned, authority on coconut. And I think there's a publication by UNIDO called Coconut Processing Technology. I think volume 7 of that has been completely written by Gamini. He's a standard reference for coconut industry. In fact, when he came to Open University as a consultant to work on the program, he wrote this part very well, coconut industry and the related things. Then he was industry management consultant, etc., etc. University days. Again, when the university talk of university, I ordered this, I picked it up from here, thing, but I want to show Gamini in this the character, Gamini. He's a finger up, talking to everyone, getting involved in everyone, very, very closely associated things, ideas are expressed openly. The finger is a good sign of Gamini, he's making a point. I like this. But when you come to university days, I think some are smiling because they can recognize this. This is a paddy field. You all can see it's a paddy field. But can you imagine where this was? This was in a faculty of engineering in 1968, the time Gamini's, Newton's, Parakramas were there. Right? These are my batchmates. I think my wife is also somewhere there. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that just tells you. Now you will wonder what on earth a paddy field in the Faculty of Engineering. You might wonder. So I'll read a small bit what I wrote in 1970. I'll read it up because I got about an hour, no? You gave me about 45 minutes. I'll read a bit, right? We were undergraduates in the 1960s, the late 60s, a period of austerity and import restrictions enforced to boost the country's economy through domestic production. The everyday luxuries some enjoy now, such as basmati rice and KFC, were not heard of at that time. Instead, we had barriers for rice transportation called Harpulu and CFC, Freon's enough refrigerators. I mean, that's a funny, fun part of it. Then, I remember around that time, Peradini Effect had a lush green paddy field in front, displaying our contribution to the national effort. The dean of the faculty, Professor E.O. Pereira, may have thought that the engineering students dabbling in the science of engineering should be given a glimpse of paddy growing and that being the major economic activity in the country. But poor us, we were the guinea pigs of this. Now I am expressing my views and my feeling at that time. Growing paddy was far removed from our minds. Even those who came from paddy growing areas after entering the engineering faculty wanted to embark on a journey of engineering full of theory and gadgetry. We all wanted to forget the grim reality of mud and cow dung and enter a world of computers, though at that time, even to enter the computer, we had to use punch cards. It was a very old computer, you know. That time, I'll come to that time again. Unfortunately for us, bigger brains were at work, bigger than our brains, were at work to make us back to the past we wanted to forget and put us back into the mud. It was a soft landing device, clearly controlled by the dean, etc. No, I can go on like that, but what I want to say, this act of growing paddy and planting paddy seedlings also seeded us, it planted some seeds in us to look at what is happening around us, you know, that seedling. Not only we did the thing, I think we also did a harvesting ceremony, I think. We harvested it. It was a complete cycle. It was not just one-off. In addition to that, if you remember, we had sheep in the faculty. In the corridors, sheep used to walk up and down. So we, to some extent, we were given a different exposure from the things, right? Then Gamini, now let me go back to the light moments of Gamini. Now we are talking about Gamini, not so much about benefits. Gamini was an instructor, I was told at that time. I didn't have that experience, but I heard it from a reliable source. Gamini was a very exuberant character. He had a motorbike, used to do horse-roll stunts on the motorbike. Then he became instructor. And at that time, the students sit for meals, and there's a high table, or something like that, facing them. Students are seated. So high table is occupied by the lecturers and instructors. So when something happens those days, something in calamity or something unexpected happens, we resort to a hoot, which we still do as undergraduates. So that particular day, while everyone was having their meal, dinner, I think dinner most probably, and Gamini with the high table up there, there was a total power failure. So of course, we had to hoot, and there was no other response to the power failure. So hoot. But from where did the first hoot come? It came from the high table, so you can imagine, I don't want to. For a moment, Gamini had forgotten where he was. Anyway, so that's Gamini, you know. That is Gamini. Now I will show you the next slide. Now, because after seeing this, when I go to this, you might think this is a terrace paddy field. I mean, you try to associate and say, you had a terrace paddy field. This is not a terrace paddy field. This is what we call, in the proper term, open air theater. But in our jargon, it's called Valley Salam. Valley Salam. It's called Valley Salam. And what are the Salam we had? Manane, Singhavau. So the paddy field, the cultural impact, the type of sheep, hybrid sheep. So it was a total different exposure we had. And I think Gamini was very much influenced by it, apart from the fact that his father and said that he was a patriotic citizen at heart, at how we worked in Polonnaruwa and that it reminds me of Gamini's character. Anyway, these, of course, then I keep on showing this. People might think, oh, so you only had paddy fields and open air theater. No, we also had very modern things. I think these are not the Boeing, these are not the Rolls Royce engine. These are piston-driven engine in the lab. This is what I call Mahalingam era. That lab, if anyone is keen to see what that era is, you must go and see that lab. Almost everything there is made in his hands, in his designs, and there are people who have directly contributed to his achievements. These one of it, there are so many other things. I was told that when you do oration, you not only talk about him, that you have to talk about me, which I thought is a bit funny. Me, in the sense, my relation to Gamini. To be frank, I had a lot of tough time with Gamini. Arguments, the namesake might be the two names clashed because we were designing a course on agricultural engineering for the first time in a university, and he was looking after the processing part, coconut, rubber, and things like that. We were writing the lessons and we had problems because it's not a problem of basic problem, but the way of teaching, the way we do distance education, and things like that. He also would not mince words. I mean, he would call a spade a spade. But he didn't mean any harm. Somehow, as you said, he left a big impression on me. Though we had a lot of differences of opinion, he had a lot of impression in me. The last time I met him was at Russell De Silva's dinner. I think some of you were there. We were seated at the same table, as usual. Gamini, after a few drinks, kept the whole crowd going in the normal way, with his pranks, with his jokes. It was unbelievable. Now, let me go back to what I set out to do. I am not, it might be a bit nostalgic to talk about your paddy fields and Mahalingam era, Kulasinghe era and things like that. But let it be. We try to reflect on our past and think it was more glorious, it's better than now. That's a common failing, but I am not doing that. I might be doing it subconsciously, but what I want to say is at that time, the university, I think Leon Deliver was also there, we had no, what is the best, the most advanced instrument we had in our hand? I don't know whether you are, young people, it's a slide rule. When I show a slide rule to people and I say, this is a logarithmic scale, you can multiply and then divide and then they think I'm talking rubbish, or I'm talking of another world, fairy tales. We had no calculators, I mean, leave aside computers. Of course, we had a one massive computer, mainframe computer, and it was not meant for this type of use. That was the setting. When I say setting, I'm not saying for a moment lack of facilities, going back to slide rule is going to make you a better engineer. What I'm saying is lack of things, not having calculators and not having computers doesn't make you a bad engineer. That's the message I want to tell you. Because sometimes the fact that I think most of you are engineers, I'll just tell you, when you use a slide rule, you do your multiplication, it doesn't give you a decimal point. It just gives you a number. If you multiply 10 by 2 or 100 by 200, it still gives the same answer, right? So where does the multiple, where does the decimal point come from your head? But that's what you call reality check. A reality check. You have to do, you have to know what the hell you are, sorry, what you are doing, and you have to fix the decimal place because you are an engineer. And also as an engineer, I always try to tell this to my students, that they think I'm talking rubbish. You don't need third decimal place most of the time. Two decimal places will be quite enough for most of the work. Because what do they say? They say, don't get it exactly wrong, but get it roughly right. That's what we are. Our slide rule serve all the purposes. Thinking, reality check, roughing it out, rounding up, all that was built into that. That is one aspect. I think like Gamini to some extent, I had an exposure in the industry for about 20-25 years. Then I switched to academia. I joined the Open University with my charter, and of course to build a career in the university, you had to do a postgraduate degree. So I went abroad and did a postgraduate degree. Not that I went, they sent me and did a postgraduate degree in post-harvest technology. And my field was looking after mangoes after harvest. I mean, might sound a bit silly, no, for a mechanical engineer to look after mangoes after harvest, but you know, the beauty of it is you can still use your mechanical engineering knowledge to handle a subject like that. You know, because of fruit, a mango respires after. It respires, right? And it creates free energy and entropy. So you can measure the respiration rate using a gas chromatograph and check how long it will last and what type of things make it respire more. So I used nothing but entropy to study the whole problem. That is, if you put stress on a fruit, any fruit, it will respire more, it will rot faster. And of course, everyone knows one way of putting it to sleep is to put it in the fridge. But some fruits can't be put in the fridge, you know that. So they need special treatment. So you know, this crossing borders from mechanical to fruit and fruit physiology and biology, was not a big deal at that time. But now, I think it might sound a big deal, I think. Someone was asked to do a thing like that, he will say, no, no, I'm not trained in that. I'm trained as a chemical engineer. I don't know fruits. I don't handle fruits. Okay. Now, this is the other thing I want to tell you now. We had, I was talking about this farm in Karadidya. We had a regional center in Polgolla, and we had a paddy field, organic paddy field there, and we used to sell our produce to the staff. Once we closed it up, I started a farm in Nawala. When I say I started, not that I started a farm, I think the instrument is starting a farm. And the farm was across a small canal, and we had difficulty of going across, so this was built. Normally, in engineering terms, you call it a suspension bridge, but the technical is called a suspended bridge, because this handrail, what you see there, is not supporting a deck. The deck is supported by a cable underneath, so it is not suspended from that cable. So there's a technical difficulty. Anyway, the fact is, my friend Para helped me to drive the NPL, and we did all this, just two chaps working. All this was free. Gamini from Plantation gave me the cables, someone gave me something, Leko gave the end joint. All this was free. This is about 30-40 feet, I think. I don't know about 30-40 feet. If you ask me what the cost is, I'll say 2,500 rupees, something like that. This is not exaggeration. Why we did this was partly we wanted to go across, and we found when we were going across, going to villages, we had something called a rural engineering program. Going to villages, we found that they had immense problems like this, crossing small streams. So we thought this was a thing that we can build and show, and people will do. Let me also give a lighter moment about the bridge. We used to go to villages after building this with photographs, how to build it, and explain it to them. But okay, we start by saying, we are not an NGO, we are from a university, we don't have money, we can only give you knowledge. If you start building it, we can help you to build it. So that's a good, not a very good message these days, you know. So when we went to some particular village and explained the whole thing, they were talking to each other and laughing away, especially the women. So I was a bit intrigued. I didn't want to ask them what is the joke about. So I waited till it's over. I went to one of the girls who organized it, and I asked, what was funny about? What do you call this in Sinhala? Sangili Palama. Sangili Palama. Sangili Palama. Nah, sir, apita Sangili Palama tibuna. Apit itisala dahadani ke taila palang hadana ke la kiwa. Ada ya, kalau tuh hadir kan, nih Sangili Palama kan, apit ayah gua mah, apit tina Sangili Palama kira. Apa tuh dekke nih? Nah, sir, dekat apit kan nih Helivili Palama kira. Heli Valley, not Helivili. Heli Valley Palama. So, apa Heli Valley Palama? Ikan ni gagal waktu waktu itu nama yang duduk tinggal lagi gagal kan? So see how smart they are, right? You can outsmart them. So that was the end of the Heli Valley Palama. Okay. So now I think I talked about Don Abram Ranasinghe a little. I forgot to read. He was also at Anand. I think he was also past. And I think in the last para, she says, my husband was, in a less public manner, a real patriot who loved his country and was immensely proud of it. This word patriot, is that the correct pronunciation? Patriot or patriot or whatever it is. There are two kinds of patriots. Exclusive and inclusive. Now you tend to get a lot of exclusive patriots, but I think he was a very all-inclusive patriot. I when I read about him, that's the impression I get. And Gamini too was like that. Now let's come back to that era and what such people thought of, such people tried to do. There are examples I don't want to quote because they are here, they will be embarrassed if I quote them. One, of course, Haley's, which will continue to do that. About paddy, there are experts on paddy coming from that era. Some are in other countries, world renowned figures on paddy harvesting, storing and processing. Now, I have a grand nephew. That grand nephew means my sister's daughter's son, who did second upper in civil engineering at Peradeniya. So I keep talking to him. All the time I talk to him about our experience and his experience. We are talking about a 50-year gap. So I keep understanding. It is another world. It's another world altogether. There is no point in talking about your things other than like you know, bedtime stories, you can tell them. But what is the problem? The way I see, I talk of Mahalingam's lab, Eupetra's paddy field, and how they planted seeds in us. Now, if you were to do a thing like that, you would first call for a tender and get all the equipment down, or give it to a contractor to do everything. And if you look at some of the research being done, you know, I am not I am not asking you to go back to stridual days. But what I feel is, I find that there are a lot of final year projects have been done on robots and what is it, drones. I mean, okay, that is these are computer IT era, so you are involved in that. In a lighter way, can I ask a guy who is doing drones whether he can make a drone to pop coconuts? You might laugh. Most of you will laugh. Mad guy. But think seriously. Think seriously. I don't know you. You are aware what the cost of plucking coconut, how difficult it is to get pluckers, and all what I got to do. A drone will have to go from tree to tree. Small saw, cut the thing, and it will fall. You don't have to collect, do anything. I'm just saying, but why aren't we thinking in those terms? I'm not asking you to design a drone for plucking coconuts, but why aren't we thinking of such applications? Now, Farah and I, we've been working for 5 years on tree plucking. Now, tree plucking, I don't know whether anyone is interested about tree plucking, but what are the main income? Tea, rubber, and coconut. And then, of course, exporting other even as slaves, I don't know, some kind of, I don't know, as, that's okay. But are we interested, are we as engineers or as lecturers, training engineers, are we looking at any of those possibilities around you? Or do you think it is redundant? Do you think, then normally if you talk like this, they'll say, so you want to go back to bullock cart days? I don't know. You can have a bullock cart with a lot of electronic controls, I think. I don't know enough of bullock carts or electronic, but I'm sure you can. There are no high and low tech, it's what you apply. So, tree plucking is a major thing. And you know, for people who are not quite aware, no, I am from a tea grow. My younger days, I was on a tea plant. My father was in a tea plant. I was a tea plant. I know tea. We never use fertilizer. When I tell this to people, they say, you would have forgotten. You may not know. But did we use cow dung? We had a cow shed. We used cow dung. We never used. Guys who know about tea, especially you. Color salt, unheard of. They are talking about 20 million, 50 million. The equipment that come into the tea factory, when people say tea is not making money, tea is this, gone, and things like that. Think of the past. Why didn't they use color sorter, very expensive equipment? Because the plucking was perfect, right? For whatever reason. You can say under slave, virtual slave labor arrangement, plucking was perfect. So there was no need to remove stalk and fiber to that extent as is now done now. Now it is just opposite, it has gone to the other extreme. Virtually, you can just pluck anything and bring to the tree. So, solution is in plucking. If a person can't be paid to pluck like this, 8 hours a day, then you have to do something, give a handheld machine or something else. Why aren't we thinking of it instead of crying about end of the industry, death of the industry and the like. Things like we have to support them. I don't know whether I have any more to say, leave some room for you to ask anything. But I want to finish it by reading this. I want to read Barry Pomeroy. I think people must be aware of his book, Science and Survival. And before that, he wrote a book called The Closing Circle. What he mean by closing circle is that you must production, consumption, disposal must be closed. Should be a closed circle. It's a very old idea. This book was written in 1970, not now. Then in 1960, he wrote Science and Survival. He says at the end, I want to just quote that and stop. Main causes of technology mismatch, right? He's not talking about going back to this technology, not matching. Technology mismatch is due to erosion of scientific integrity, right? I think we had something, we knew something called scientific integrity. He says erosion of scientific integrity and profit, I put William Becker's only driven technology, profit. I'll give you an example. I think my colleagues, mechanical engineers, when you were doing engineering, there were only three areas, civil, mechanical and electrical. And the selection was based on what? On what you want to do. We never said civil pays more, there are more jobs, mechanical had more jobs. That would have been there, but it never crossed my mind. In fact, I shouldn't have done mechanical going by those standards. So I started my life as an engineer CTP. I don't know. So think the only says scientific integrity and profit-driven technology. Profit-driven technology could also mean profit-driven education. I mean, then of course you might say, yeah, so no need of livelihood. I don't know about livelihood. I think at that time we started working, we would have got 600 rupees a month and we lived. I mean, we didn't die, we lived, we had a beer occasionally. So we lived with 600 at that time. So now you must be talking about 60,000 rupees. But you still live, and but we are still complaining about your credit cards and overpayment for car lease and things like that. So life goes on. He says, we have met the enemy. He inspired this by saying, we have met the enemy. And he says, and he says, if there is a technology mismatch, enemy says. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for that lovely lecture. And in order to present a memento for this lecture, I would like to invite Engineer Newton Vikramasuriya to the stage to present this memento to Dr. Gamini Kulathunga. Next, I would like to invite Captain Nalaka, Engineer Captain Nalaka Gunasinghe, who is a committee member of the Agricultural Sectoral Committee of IESL, to present a message of condolence to Mr. Gamini Ranasinghe's sister, Kushlani Amarasuriya. I apologize. Mr. Mahesh Disanayake will present a special letter to Ms. Kushlani Amarasuriya. Thank you. And in order to deliver the vote of thanks, I would like to invite Captain Nalaka Gunasinghe to the stage.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, I am not the one who was to give this vote of thanks. It was Mahesh. Suddenly, I was told to give, and I consider it's a bit privilege because I had a lot of association with Gamini. And just to tell you that thing, something he tried to do, I think that only myself and him knew about it, and to connect IESL with RRI, Rubber Research Institute. When I tried to once to see how it was, we found that the Rubber Research Institute, which has large amount of machinery being used, but didn't have a single engineer in that organization. Only the technical by senior most is physical science graduate. Then the company had the idea, somehow we must help. I went about a few times with it. With actual they sponsored vehicles and everything, we tried to connect the IESL to them through the Agriculture Sectional Committee. And that was the one thing he did, and after he relinquished the chairman and I was the chairman of the Sectional Committee, we continued. And after that, I didn't know, by the time when I joined, that chapter had been lost. I think that we should, as an honor to him, we should continue. That's why I request his assistance from this madam and others that we should do something like that. Then, let me come to this vote of thanks. First of all, I must thank Dr. Kulath Gamini Kulathunga, come all the way and give the lecture. And he has taken a lot of trouble and he entertained all of us in a certain matter to introducing who Gamini was. Some people didn't know about it. Thank you very much for Dr. Kulathunga coming and give this valuable words and then this wouldn't have been reality if not for the mechanical IMechE Institute of Mechanical Engineering Sri Lanka chapter. In that way, the Charuka engineer Charuka took a role, and we must thank the membership and chairman and the membership of this IMechE local chapter. And how agriculture and a sectional committee came. It would have been reality if not for Mr. Engineer Chula. This is Allah. He is the one who came, but he's doing something else. And and he's the one who actually spoke to me and see how we could help each other. Then things, a lot of mails came and sank to the officers of the IESL. So we were able to connect this agriculture sectional committee to make, because he was a very prominent member of the agriculture sectional committee of IESL and was the president twice, and he represented that means was in IESL in the council. Actually, really speaking, that particular time, due to less number, some people were talking about to abolish that agriculture sectional committee from this. But he's the one who resurrected and did something. Now, after contribution of many, now it is doing quite okay. And thanks for him. That's one other thing. And so that now agriculture sectional committee, when it came to the help this one. And Mahesh and Ilanti and many members helped him, and thank you for them as well. And one of the most, otherwise it would create a huge vacuum if that to Madam Ranasinghe and her husband, if not you are not here, this would have been, that would have created a huge vacuum, it would have been a half worthless. Thank you very much for your presence here and for this occasion. Crazing, it's a wonderful appearance in this one. Thank you very much indeed, madam. Then I must thank president of the IESL and former and the officials who were here and showed the importance of this one. Thank you very much, madam. Sir. Then what I have to say is that there's a lot of support from IESL, the officials, our CEO and Mrs. Ramani, they helped us. Ultimately, IESL gave this whole, if not free of charge, to conduct the lecture. It was a very good thing, and thank you very much for all those involved and supported us this way. Then, that is that, oh, I don't want to make it longer. And so finally, and not the least, I will thank for you all and came you here all the way and attend this lecture. Thank you very much for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Captain Nalaka, Engineer Captain Nalaka Ranasinghe. And in conclusion, I would like to invite you all for dinner at the Members' Lounge. And I wish you all a very pleasant evening. Thank you.
I will not be able to join you at dinner. It's partly because of my condition, health condition. But I got a feeling that you were to have a question time. It's okay. There's no questions. Better if there's no question. But I forgot to mention one thing, because Mr. Jaisinghe and is instrumental in running a design course for engineers. A design course for engineers, working engineers. So they come up with their own ideas about design ideas. One I am supposed to be mentoring. Don't laugh. This is coconut scraper. Because people, my friend, good friends ask, Taumu Polgana? They ask. Yeah, I say yes, Taumu Polgana. Because that is because you don't know what Polgana is. You go to Avance. You can go also to Chinese, what is that? I'm talking about now. When they ask, are you Tango Polgano? Are they Odisla Polgavani? Are you Amala Polgava? But I'm talking about the present day. Abans. You go to Abans and what is that Chinese website? Alibaba. Go to Alibaba, click Polgano, not Polgano, coconut scraper. You will see unbelievable range of coconut scrapers. In fact, I'm a coconut scraping fan. I have three kinds at home. And I know this is not a lecture of coconut scraping. No, I'm just telling you, come back to ground, for heaven's sake, come back to ground. If you are scraping coconut, look at it. That this boy is doing something marvelous. And when people ask, Taumo Polgano, I beg you to go to Alibaba or to Abba's website and see what the coconut scraper is. Of course, all this is there. So, Polgano. So, my conclusion is, please. Do something down to earth. Okay, thank you.